Hello and welcome to a new video on the CrypTool YouTube channel and the Basics of Cryptology series. In this video, I want to speak about cryptographic hash functions. I structured this video into different parts. In the first part, I want to discuss non-cryptographic hash functions. Then I want to speak about cryptographic hash functions. After that, I want to have a look at applications of cryptographic hash functions. And finally, I want to give you some example cryptographic hash functions that are also implemented in CrypTool 2. As with all videos of the Basics of Cryptology series, I want to have a look at where we are right now with respect to cryptology. And in this video, we are at cryptology, cryptography, modern cryptography. And we are not in symmetric or asymmetric modern cryptography. This here refers to ciphers. We are right now with modern hash functions. So actually we should have here hash functions that are also modern cryptography. What is a non-cryptographic hash function? A non-cryptographic hash function, or a hash function, is a function which maps data from arbitrary size to a fixed size. So the function performs some kind of compression. You can see here this graphics. On the left side we have a bit string of arbitrary length, so it can be even 0 bit to arbitrary length of bits, and this goes into our hash function, and then the hash function returns a fixed value of, for instance, n bits. And with the hash function, with different length that you put in, you always get the same length output. And the return value of a hash function is called the hash value, or the hash code, the digest, or just simply the hash. Hash functions are, for instance, used in data storage, for instance, for hash tables. You probably heard about hash tables when you are a programmer or when you program software. You use these to store data and to efficiently get data from the hash table. And also hash functions are used for error detection in communication protocols, for instance, to check if a message that you send and received has some kind of errors. And hash functions have to be deterministic. That means when you input the same value here, you should get the same output value here. Then they should map the expected inputs as evenly as possible over its output range. So you should not have holes into your bit string here. So all the bits should be equally used by your hash function. And of course, since we can put in arbitrary length of data, it should be computationally efficient. And that means that the hash function computation should be fast. What is a cryptographic hash function? At first of all, a cryptographic hash function or cryptographic hash functions have to fulfill all properties of non-cryptographic hash functions, since a non-cryptographic hash function is clearly a hash function. And these cryptographic hash functions should be easy to compute in one direction, but difficult to compute in the other direction. So you put in a message, you compute the cryptographic hash function, you get your hash or your hash value. This way is easy. But when you have a hash value, it should be difficult to get your message. And additionally, cryptographic hash functions have to fulfill the following three properties. The first property is a pre-image resistance. That means that given a hash value h, it should be difficult to find any message m such that h equals to hash of that message m. And this is a difficult property going from the right to the left. And it should be even impossible to find another message. So it should not be it must not be the original message. It can be another message, but you should not be able to find it easily. Then we have the second property, and that is the second pre-image resistance. And that means given an input M1, it should be difficult to find a different input M2 such that hash M1 equals to hash M2. That's what I just described. You cannot find another message that has the same message as your original message. That should be very difficult. And then we have the collision resistance. And that means it should be difficult to find two different messages, M1 and M2, such that hash M1 equals to hash M2. And you now say probably, but this is the same as the second pre-image resistance. But it's not. With the second pre-image resistance, our M is fixed. So it should not be able to find another message to that fixed M1 message that I already have, that the hashes are equal. But with the collision resistance, this is even harder. harder criteria, and it is easier for an attacker because he can choose both messages here. So M1 he can choose and M2 he can choose. So we have no fixed M1. And even that has to be impossible. You cannot find two messages, M1 and M2, that their hashes are equal, because this would be a so-called collision. And yeah, if only one property of these three properties is broken, so you have you can find the pre-image, or you can find a second pre-image, or you can even find a collision, then if you only can do one of these three, then the complete hash function is considered broken and should not be used anymore. Now let's have a look at some applications of cryptographic hash functions. Our first application is message and file integrity verification. And an example for this is a file hash of a setup program shown on a download server. So for instance, you want to download an executable to install a program, and then you have on that web page a hash value. And what do? You download the executable, and then you compute the hash value of your downloaded file. And then you compare your computed hash with the hash from the download page. And if these hashes are different, you know that the setup program has been modified before you downloaded it, or maybe while you download it. And it's not the exact same file that they provide. So maybe there's a virus inside, or it's a different version, but so you shouldn't execute it right now. You should check why the hash is different. The second example is signature generation and verification. An example for this is an email signature with RSA. And how is this done? When you sign your email, you compute a hash value of the email, and then you sign it, for instance, with RSA. If you don't know what RSA is, or you're interested in the details of RSA, you should have a look at my video about RSA. And the receiver then, who receives the email, also computes the hash of the email, and then he decrypts the signature, because you used your private key to encrypt, and he can decrypt with your public key. And then when the hash values are equal, he knows that the email comes from you, and he also knows that the email has not been changed by someone else. Then we have as application the password verification and of course storage. An example is a password stored in a database. So instead of storing a clear password or a clear text password in the database, passwords are stored as hash values. And what does the system do when you log in? It takes your clear text password, it computes the hash value, and it compares the hash value that it has stored in the database with the hash value that it computed. And if both hash values are equal, the system knows that the passwords are equal and you gain access. And if they are not equal, then the system knows that you entered a wrong password. But an administrator who looks into the database cannot see your password, since he only sees the hash value. Another application for cryptographic hash functions are proof of work. And an example for a proof of work application, for instance, is cryptocurrency, for example, Bitcoin. And I don't want to go into details. Proof of work just means you find a hash value with some specific properties, for instance, with a pattern at the beginning, or with some a number of zeros at the beginning, and this is hard, and then you can prove that when you found this, that you spent some computational work. I will make a video specifically on cryptocurrencies probably in the future. And our last application for cryptographic hash functions are file or data identifiers. Example for this are the identification of files in Git or SVN repositories. Here, the files are also identified using cryptographic hash functions. Now let's have a look at some example cryptographic hash functions. And you probably know the message digest algorithm 5, or short MD5. And it has a bit size of 128, and it's completely broken. So in the past, I saw some people still using MD5. And since it's completely broken, you should not do this. You can easily compute collisions with MD5. It's broken. The only interesting thing with MD5 is for educational purpose. Then the next hash function is the secure hash algorithm 1, or short SHA-1. It has a bit size of 160 bit, and it's also broken. So some years ago, I don't remember, 3, 4, maybe 5 years ago, some researchers actually computed a collision for SHA-1. They used a lot of computational power for this, but yeah, they showed that you can compute a collision, and an attacker with enough computational power can do this again. So you should never use SHA-1 again for serious purpose. Then we have the successor, the secure hash algorithm 2, short SHA-2, and it has 224, 256, 384, or 512 bits. So there are different versions of this algorithm, and this algorithm is not broken. Then we have the secure hash algorithm 3, SHA-3, also known as Keshak. This is a newer one, and it has also 224, 256, 384 and 512 bit. It's also not broken. And if I would have to choose an hash function for a serious purpose or for an application I want to develop, my first choice would have been or would be the SHA-3 algorithm, and my second choice would be the SHA-2 algorithm. Then I have two other examples for hash functions that we have also in Crypto2. This is the Race Integrity Primitives Evaluation Message Digest, or RIPE-MD, which has 128, 160, 256, or 320 bit. This is also not broken and implemented in Crypto2. And then, for example, we have Whirlpool, which has 512 bits, and this is also not broken. Now let us have a look at some cryptographic hash function we have in Crypto2, and I also want to show you an attack on the MD5 hash algorithm. I'm here now in Crypto2, and I want to show you where you can find hash algorithms or cryptographic hash algorithms. In the start center, you go to hash functions here, and there they are. And the first hash function I want to show you is the MD5 hash function. And for that, I opened the template. And what you can see here is that we have our input value, our hash function MD5 here, and the hash value. And when you click on play, it just computes for you the MD5 hash. And what you can see here is when you make a small change, for instance, you just remove that dot here, that the complete hash here changes. Let's have a look how many bits change. For that, we click on the text output component here, go to settings, and we say show changes and show only differences. And since we want to see the bits, we remove that connection here. And then we go to string decoder, no, encoder, sorry, string encoder. You connect this here and this here. And with the string encoder, we set this to binary. And you click play. And then you see here the hash value. And now we add the missing dot here from our text. And you see that these bits all change. And like with modern ciphers, on average, 50% of the bits with a hash function should also change. Now let's have a look at an attack on the MD5 hash function. I said previously in this video that you should never use MD5 for any serious purpose. And we implemented an attack on MD5. It's called MD5 Collision Finder. You can find it here in the templates. Double click this. And then what do we see here? I will just start and then explain during the run what happens. So you can choose, it just took 1 second to find the collision here. So you have a seed that the MD5 collision finder needs. Then we have a prefix, which has to be a multiple of 64 bytes. Then we have a suffix, just some random text, and it generates something between the prefix and the suffix. So when you compute here, where do we have the MD5 values? We have here the MD5s, the MD5 values here, that when you compute the MD5 values of this here and this here, you get the same MD5 values. So let's have a look at the texts. So we see here our prefix, then something in the middle that the the collision finder computed, and then we have the suffix here. And same happen, yeah, we can see here. So we have the same prefix and we have the same suffix. But here in the middle, for instance, we see this H here. We see the H also here. Where do we see something that is different? So here, we see here a Y. We see here an HY. So these tags are clearly different, but the hash values aren't. And what can an attacker do now? An attacker can provide, for instance, a program that behaves differently. So for instance, the attacker shows you the program, he executes it, and nothing bad happens. Because the program, yeah, is this version here. And in the suffix, the program looks at, yeah, this part here and sees, so here is, what do we have? Here is no H at that position. I don't do anything bad. And then he gives you this program that you execute on your computer. And then the program sees here's the HY. And then the program does something really bad because it has the Y here. And the code that comes here when it's here a program that looks at this. And yeah, it has a different behavior. And you could also, or you could even compute the hash value to check if this is the same program that the attacker gave you. And yeah, the hash value is the same. So that's the reason why you should never use MD5, because you can easily compute, yeah, such collisions. And we can even do this in CrypTool. So it took 1 second here. So let's, yeah, restart it. 0 seconds. It's just incredibly fast. So now let's have a look at another hash function. So we have, for instance, here SHA-3. Where do we have it? Here we have Keshak. And here we have, yeah, the input, the Keshak algorithm. And it has a nice, yeah, explanation how it works. But I think when I make it small and execute, yes, then you see here the hash value. And you see when you change your text, the hash value also changes. So this is the Keshak hash function. And we also have SHA-1. We have many different hash functions implemented. Then we have, for instance, here we have the SHA-1 collision in CrypTool. And these are the original files that the researchers found. Ah, here you can see on February 23rd, 2017, a collision attack on SHA-1 was presented by researchers from the National Research Institute for Mathematics and Computer Science in the Netherlands and the Google Research Security Privacy and Anti-Abuse Group. And you have here the two different, I think these were files, I don't remember, PDF maybe. Yeah, we have a good PDF and a bad PDF. So we have here good PDF. I will make it, you can see it. We have here the good PDF, the bad PDF, and these are encoded as hex values, of course. So we make binary data of it, and then we compute the SHA-1 values. And when you execute this, you see here that both hash values are the same. So you should not use SHA-1 anymore. You can compute these collisions. Of course, an attacker needs a lot of computational power. Maybe it's also stands here. No, it doesn't. I don't know how many computers they use, but an attacker having a lot of computing power can do this, so you should never use SHA-1 again. And now I want to show you a final attack that you can do with passwords, and this is a dictionary attack on a password hash value. So what do we have here in this complex workspace? So we have here a hash value for a given test password. And you have to assume, when I give you a hash value of a good password, a good hash function, with a good hash function, you should not be able to compute the original password. Since a good password means it's long, it has some special characters, and it's longer than 12 letters, for instance, with special signs and so on. And then you cannot compute it. But when you have a bad password that you can, for instance, find in a dictionary, for instance, you use a name or you use cat or dog or just a word that you can find in a dictionary, then you can perform a dictionary attack. And what does a dictionary attack mean? It means that you take every entry of the dictionary, you compute the hash value for each of these entries, and then you compare the hash value that you computed with the hash value of the password you want to attack. And this complex workspace does this. So you see here, it walks through all the words of the dictionary, and it's kind of slow right now because the text output here is open, and that blocks the execution here or makes it slower. And you see here how many hashes or how many passwords it tested or how many words, and here you see the position of the search space. But if you make this smaller here and you make this smaller here, then you see it's really fast. So, and the password here was ancient. So ancient gives us the same hash value as the stored hash value. So when you use a password or have to create a password for an application or for web service or whatever where you need to log in, you should use a long password and, of course, with some special characters, with some digits and so on, to make it more complex that this dictionary attacks and search attacks are not possible. Yeah, and this was everything that I wanted to show you with hash function in this short video. I hope you liked it. If yes, please give a thumbs up. If no, you know what to do, give a thumbs down. And if you did not yet subscribe to our YouTube channel and you're interested in more about cryptology, cryptography, cryptanalysis, I would be really happy if you subscribe to our channel. So, see you in the next video.